Thank you so much, Daniel. Thank you for inviting me to this session here. It's an honor being here. If you attended the first session, you would have heard an awful lot about fencing treaties or fight books. There are clear examples of how to fight in these books, and we very briefly touched upon the subject of what is the real purpose of these books. And just last year I did a paper together, wrote an article together with Daniel, published here in Arte Periodica, on how to interpret these things and things to look out for if you're a researcher working with such treaties. Because one of the things that we really argued in this article is that the background context, the overall context, is all important in order to understand these treaties, in order to work with them. And that's what I'm going to be showing some examples of here today. When the title of my paper is King Christian IV and his fencing masters, it should really be something like King Christian IV, Danish martial arts culture, a look behind the scenes. Because this, what is really happening behind the scenes, is so important. Are we fighting to kill each other? Is it fighting in a war? Are we speaking about a civil context? What is it we're really talking about here? And is it possible to distinguish between these things, as some has argued here earlier today that it's not? But I'm going to be arguing that it is really possible to distinguish between it. But let's take a quick look upon the guy I'm talking about, King Christian IV, King of Denmark from 1588 until 1648, the longest reigning monarch in Danish history. He was the third in line of Danish kings after the Reformation. When we went from being a Catholic nation to being a Protestant nation. So that also means he was one of the first Danish Renaissance kings, with everything that applies to that. He was a real warrior king. He was deeply into jousting. He jousted daily. He forced his sons to joust daily. He had this idea that when the Danish nobility jousted, that perhaps they should also use on to jousting with pistols, but the Danish nobility said that it's simply too dangerous, we won't do that. And just like his father before them, but before him, he went to war just simply to check, put a cross on the check list, says, yes, I'm a real Danish Renaissance monarch, I went to war. So he went to war against Sweden, just like his father, for no reason at all except going to war. It's true, that was the reason, it's because he needed to do that as a true Renaissance monarch. So he was really keen on proving himself. In 1611, he went to war against Sweden. It's called the Kalmar War. And it's really interesting because we have some preserved diaries from that war, from some of the Danish nobility. And it's clear that all the fighting is done around this person. So wherever he's camped, that's fighting being done. But where the rest of the Danish nobility is placed, they're not really interested in fighting. It's really a fantastic thing. The Danish high nobility, his name was Eske Brock, he wrote down that saying that we were at camp, well away from the king. And we said that perhaps we should do something. The king expects us to fight, and we sat down there, all the Danish high nobility, and we decided upon not doing anything. And we needed a reason for not doing anything, and suddenly it came to us that we should not go foraging into Sweden, because we've heard that there's no beer left in Sweden. So, but that is an example of this thing that perhaps when people went to war, all were perhaps not equally interested in this war. But he was, and he was heavily dependent on his nobility in order to fight in these wars. They were military commanders, they fought in cavalry units, so he needed the Danish nobility. And in order to do so, he needed to take some steps in order to educate the Danish nobility in the correct way. Before I move on to that, I'll just place a short focus on this picture here, because since he was very masterly interested, of course he made sure that he had the best teachers available. And this is Salvatore Fabbri, one of the best known Italian fencing masters. And he wrote his two treatises while being in the Danish kingdom. So of course he taught the Danish king on how to fence. But the Danish king needed to teach all the young nobility. And that's why a royal academy was founded. Actually, his father, Friedrich II, founded the first academy, but that was a joint academy. It was both possible to attend that for nobles, but also burghers, rich burger sons. But in 1623, King Christian IV changed all that. He founded a strict royal academy, in German you say Ritterakademie, in Sorø, Denmark. Sorø is based here. Why did he do that? He wanted to educate the Danish nobility, all the young sons. This was a time where it was very common to go on educational journeys throughout Europe. It was expected that you did that. The problem with these educational journeys was that often the Danish young nobility went drinking through Europe. It's true. We have many, many written accounts saying that they basically used all their money on festivities, except of attending the universities and doing some real stuff there. So these were the future of Denmark. So of course the king is interested in some sort of basic education. So that was why he founded that school. Actually, the Danish nobility was against founding that school, and he had to force it down upon them. And he did that by decreeing that if your youngling does not attend this royal academy, none of them, anyone who does not attend the academy, will get an appointment at the Danish court. Now that is a real threat, because that was the future of nobility in Denmark. They were not talking about real knights anymore. The fall of the knight had happened at that time. So that was the future. So that was a real, real threat. So he had to found the school, and what they taught at the school was the right faith, the Protestant faith. That was all important. They taught politics. They taught courtly manners, and they taught noble exercises. And that's what I'm going to be talking about now, because among these noble exercises was fencing. And I think it's fun, because whenever somebody says fencing, I would say that 95% probably think something, it has something to do with a sword, because you fence with a sword. But when we're talking about this period, is of course fencing with the sword, but at this academy, it was also fencing with the pike and fencing with the musket, learning to shoot with the musket. So it was the whole package. And that's a real interesting thing here, because fencing with the sword, as I'm going to tell later on, is a civil thing, whereas fencing with the pike and the musket has to do with war. Yes. So he needed the king to invite a lot of teachers to attend the school, to teach all the Danish young nobility. And there were some dangers connected with this thing, because as he writes in a letter to the Danish high nobility, the king's council, he said that when these teachers come to the academy, they are followed by loose people, loose women, and there are servants as well, and it was not good for these people to get in contact with the Danish young nobility. So actually, the first thing he did was build a house, a specific, well-built house, big house to house all these teachers and their servants outside the grounds of the school. And then only the teachers were allowed to enter the school in order to not corrupt the young Danish nobility. So, of course, he had to hire a lot of professors. He had to hire a math professor. He had to hire a professor in logic, in theology, in dancing as well, and in fencing. And I have a list here listing how much these people earned per year. And in Danish, good Danish silver coin, called a daler, the math professor receives 400 silver coins a year, the logic professor 400, the theology professor 500, and the fencer 400. The dancer receives 300. So you have the fencer up there among the very highest paid teachers at the Royal Academy. There's one person who exceeds all of them. That is the writing teacher. He receives 1,000 Danish good silver coins. So that is the highest paid person at the academy. So what was written down also in one of these letters when the king communicated with the king's council was that these people are often invited in from Europe. And there was a danger with this free traffic of people across Europe. I'm not saying Brexit here. But the king was deeply, deeply concerned. So he ordered the headmaster of the school to very closely follow, including the fencing master, to follow him in order to make certain that he did not corrupt the young Danish nobility with foreign ideas, mostly concerning theology. We're talking about a period here where the Danish king was actually deeply concerned about this, because he strictly believed that if such mischief happens in my realm, it's going to bring down the wrath of God upon me and my country. So it's no easy thing if one of these fencing masters was a devout Catholic and he tried to turn around the Danish nobility. So it was a deeply, deeply, deeply serious matter. So, in 1623, King Christian IV wants to hire his first fencing master. And he writes a letter to one of his high nobility, one of the members of the king's council, and orders him to travel to Paris in order him to hire the famous fencing master, Vincentius. That could be one of the... we have one Vincentius mentioned by his teaching in London in the early 1600s, and it could be an example of how slow news traveled in these times. So he would probably not know the Danish king that this guy was dead, but he did publish a fine fencing book, so he was famous in some ways, but the Danish king didn't know, and the Justru is his name, travels to Paris and learns that this guy is not there. So he has to return to the king, and the king wants to find a new fencing master. And he hires this guy here, Hans Wilhelm Schoffer. He's a German fencing master, and he was educated in the Salle of Salvatore Fabris in Padua. So again, we have the connection down through Europe, through Germany to Italy. So that would be a natural choice. He was the author of the largest, most extensive fencing treaty ever created. I think it's like 1,000 pages around that. And he was prime material for this position. And when we learn, when we read these written sources concerning this hiring this person, we find out some really interesting things. For instance, that he was supposed to teach fencing at the academy, but he was supposed to bring, within his own salary and pay for it himself, his assistant.
And that is for me the first time I ever heard of a fencing assistant. And he pays for it because it's his job to teach the younglings. So that is part of his job to bring his own assistant. What we also learned when this guy is hired here is very interesting. How often were the younglings, the Danish young nobility, supposed to train fencing? And I know this has been discussed many, many, many places, and there are so few sources saying anything about this. If you know the Norwegian King's Mirror from the first part of the 13th century, it says that you have to train daily, but not how much. It says that you have to train at times with heavier swords and shields in order to strengthen yourself, but not really how much. But here we get the answer. In the Danish 17th century, you have to train half an hour per day. And we learn that very clear, simply saying that the king decrees it for his own son to train half an hour a day at the academy, as is the norm. What we also learn is that when Hans Wilhelm Schoffer is hired, the king clearly states that you must not receive any gifts from any of your students in order to buy special favors. So that is interesting as well. So we have something here that is clearly scheduled, half an hour time slot per day, just as it is with dancing, with math, with geometry, with logic, with theology, and all that stuff. It is going to school in a strict way. So that, for me, that is a fantastic source for the first time describing how much they actually train. And I was discussing this with Sixth last night. It's like playing the guitar. If you play the guitar half an hour a day, you get to be a decent guitar player, but you might not excel at what you do. That takes much more into it. And it's really interesting because when we do talk about martial arts in Europe, also in the 16th century with the German city-states, which can be compared to some things in Denmark as well. The fencers, there was the goldsmith, there was the carpenter, there was the baker. They were normal people, but this was what they did in their spare time. So that's an important part of it. So with this idea we have that when you are a fencer, you train 8 hours a day and you are invincible, that idea might not hold true. So, but he was hired here. Then in 1636, Hans Wilhelm Schoffer has become old, and it's time for a new fencing master at the academy. And this is the first time where the Danish king actually managed to hire a French fencing master before. And he taught at the academy from 1636 to 1642. He gets the same hire as Hans Wilhelm Schoffer. He has his hire has been raised from 400 good Danish silver coins to 800 silver coins. But the thing is that since Hans Wilhelm Schoffer is still alive here in 1636, he only receives half his pay, 400 coins. And it is written in his contract that when Hans Wilhelm Schoffer is no more, you are supposed to be raised to 800. So that clearly indicates that in some way this old retired, now retired fencing master was still active at the academy, perhaps being his site teacher. But this idea with before being friends, that's really interesting because we are in a period where the Danish connection to France is slowly increasing. Previously, the connection was to Germany, to Italy. And we can see that in the 16th century, when you went on an educational journey, you went to Germany and down to Italy. But in the 17th century, you went to France, Germany, France, Italy, that way. So you see a higher influence of French culture, especially at court. And Beaufort was in Denmark before 1636 because he was hired as a private teacher for the king's son before he was sent to Sorø. And when he then was sent to Sorø, he followed him to Sorø Academy.
in order to teach full time at the academy. And the Danish nobility were in an uproar. A French fencing master, what is going on? One of the masters at the academy, his name is Hans Willem Lauenberg. He was a math professor. He also taught the art of fortification at the academy. He says that he wrote a comedy, presented at court, where he said that, and now we've even hired a French fencing master to teach our younglings to kill, as if we could not do that ourselves. So the Danish nobility is in an uproar. What's this French connection? I thought it's a different thing. But what he also says, the Professor Lauenberg, and that is really interesting, is that he says that he is teaching fencing that is only designed to kill our younglings. Suddenly you have this fencing culture where one night you see two young noblemen standing next to each other, being married, drinking, having fun, and suddenly one of them says something, and the next day it results in a duel, and one of them dies. And that is our future, as he writes in this letter of complaint. And he also says that this fencing is useless on the battlefield. It is useful only for one thing, and that is this civil combat here. So he's in an uproar. He knows what he's talking about, because he's teaching the art of fortification, the art of warfare, and he complains about this. So that is really interesting, but also talking about this behind the scenes context. Okay, I'm running out of time, let's see. In 1642, the last fencing master is hired at Sorø. The academy closes in 1665, and he teaches there, and his son Casimir follows him as a fencing master, but teaches now civil fencing in Copenhagen, no longer teaches the nobility. But what is really, really interesting in this period is that we have two preserved fencing manuscripts in Denmark. And this is actually the first time I say fencing manuscript during this lecture, I think. But they were written by students. So whenever we're talking about this context of the fencing manuscripts, here perhaps we have the only two real examples of fencing manuscripts where we can for sure say what is the purpose. Because there's no commercial purpose in any way involved here. There's no bragging, there's no I can do this. This was the lectures they were taught, that was written down by these students, so it's pure knowledge in some way. And one of them is written in Denmark, I'm transcribing that at the moment, and the other is written in German, and as it says, some fencing lessons I have received on the floor from Hans Wilhelm, the fencing master in Sorø during the time I was there in the year 1657. So, as I said, these two are interesting because there we get down on the floor for the first time. Mm. I have no other examples of that anywhere. So in order to conclude, I have 1 minute, right? I think it's this work we do, analyzing the background of it all, is even more important than looking at what is described in these manuscripts, because we need to do our groundwork first in order to do what comes afterward, analyzing these techniques. And this is an example. We have shown several examples of how this very specific, specialized martial culture affects what's written in the manuscripts. Thank you.
We hold the question and answer right after the paper. So